our hosts or our guests' time, excuse me. Today, we are going to be speaking with Dr. John Lynn Jefferies about HCM and COVID during the pandemic. We're going to go into some questions there. Just as a reminder, this is an informational session held by the Hypertrophic Cardiomyopathy Association. And we're going to be going over some general questions, and we're going to go over some general information about COVID and HCM today. And without further ado, I'm going to welcome Dr. Jefferies. Welcome.
Thank you, Lisa, and thanks to everyone. I probably know some of you, and for the others that I don't, just a little bit of my background. I'm the chairman of our Cardiovascular Institute here in Memphis. Actually, I'm trained both in pediatric cardiology at Texas Children's Hospital and adult cardiology at Texas Heart Institute, all in Houston. So I have the good fortune to manage HCM patients across the entire age spectrum, from neonate all the way to nanogenarian and everything in between. And so it gives me a unique perspective, I guess. And so Lisa was kind enough to ask me to talk to you briefly just about how do we think COVID may be impacting our pediatric and young adult population with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So I want to use a little bit of time just to go through some basics and to try and bring you up to speed with some essentially real-time data that's been coming out of the American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association, Heart Failure Society of America. And as you can all appreciate, this is something that we're continuing to learn about. So with that, I'll get started. So our first slide is really just a bit of basics that you already know. COVID-19 pandemic is a rapidly growing situation. And from my perspective, it changes almost every day. I'm on a lot of leadership committees within the American College of Cardiology, and we have a lot of emails and chains going back and forth talking about how should we do this or that. And some things just as simple as wearing a mask up to which patient should be going to the operating room or to the cardiac catheterization laboratory. And so it's a very fluid situation. We do know that there are an increasing number of questions about the implications of patients with background cardiomyopathy and or the presence of heart failure and COVID-19. And we're continuing to learn more and more about this. And we'll touch a little bit about this today on how it may impact some patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And it really would probably more potentially impact those patients with more of a burned out phenotype with reduced ejection fraction. But as you all know, you know Lisa very well. She's a strong advocate. And for those that know me, I am as well. And that we want to do everything possible to avoid acquiring the virus. And I've seen data where it's potential that everyone may be exposed at some point. You know, I think it's hard to know these sorts of things longitudinally. But I do know that everything that we can do to prevent you from harboring this virus is an important step for us, because it's very hard to anticipate how any one patient is going to react. Next. So there have been some published data and guidelines sort of based data that I'm sure that all of you have seen about which populations we think may be potentially impacted. And we hear a lot about the elderly population, so meaning over the age of 80. But I can tell you in our region, and we're still on the uptick from our trajectory, is that we are starting to see pediatric patients, and there have been reports in the literature of neonates also succumbing to COVID. Now, not in the background of HCM, that's just in general. But I think it underscores the idea that you don't have to have these underlying conditions or age cutoffs to be impacted in a negative way from the virus. We do know that immunocompromised patients are folks that we are paying attention to. And most of this is theoretical, but obviously if you have a heart transplant and you have a suppressed immune system, just as the folks on the call here might know, that we get concerned about viral exposures in the setting of transplant, such as varicella and those sorts of things. this could also mirror something like that. I think the jury's probably still a little bit out about exactly what that background immunosuppressive regimen might be that might be harmful. And it really may be your underlying white counts, if you're anemic, those sorts of things. So I think that's a stay tuned kind of a picture, but something we're paying attention to. And then chronic disease. And chronic is a pretty powerful word when you think about that in general. So that applies to a lot of different diseases and disorders, but obviously in our corner of the world, cardiovascular disease is one of those chronic diseases, and that could be coronary artery disease, so like ischemic heart disease. It could be arrhythmia, like atrial fibrillation. That could be congestive heart failure or heart failure in general. It could be the preserved ejection fraction, reduced ejection fraction. And so we take all these things very seriously because we know with these conditions in place, and you all have heard this from us and others in the setting of heart failure, your immune system may not function exactly correctly. We know oftentimes you're catabolic and hypermetabolic, and so your ability to mitigate concomitant disease such as a pneumonia or such as a viremia may not be optimal. As we alluded to earlier, we are seeing patients more and more that do not have these sort of requisite quote unquote comorbidities. And I'll tell you, if you think about it, if this is really a normally distributed, exposure, such as a Gaussian kind of a distribution, there are going to be people that don't have these in the background that are going to develop COVID-19 evidence of infection and significant morbidity and probably mortality. But on the other end of that curve, there'll be a lot of people that are asymptomatic. And as you're starting to see now across multiple institutions, what we thought about, cough, fever, those sorts of things, evidently has been, a driver. And I think it was appropriate because of resource and access. But now we're starting to appreciate that maybe those sort of symptom profiles don't always apply. And so just something to keep in mind when we're managing something like a pandemic. Next. Next slide.
I got it. It's the COVID statement from CDC.
I just wanted to speak briefly about the COVID-19. This chronic heart disease is one of those situations, as we said, that I think we have to be very mindful of. And so you can appreciate here on the screen, this is a recommendation from the CDC, and I'm sure all of you have heard this, but basically people with chronic heart diseases should obviously, if there's an outbreak in your community, individuals should stay at home as much as possible. And everyone is aware of this. And this is the possibility of reducing your risk of being exposed. Exposure doesn't necessarily mean that you will acquire the virus, but it is something, it's sort of a common sense approach and you hear us say this all the time, if you know people have the flu, don't go around them. So those are typical mantras that we would tell our cardiomyopathy patients. And as I was alluding to earlier, there has been this idea about fever and malaise and cough, other things about potentially seeing your healthcare provider. But as we learn more about the disease, the presentation of the viral infection, it can be various and sundry and quite broad, such as impaired or lost sense of smell or taste, some other things that people have been talking about. So I think as healthcare providers, we need to be relatively open-minded when it comes to what the presentation may look like. And as you all know, if you have significant obstruction, for example, you may have a cough, you may be a little bit congested, but it may not be because of a virus. It may be because of diastolic dysfunction and atrial hypertension and pulmonary congestion, right? So those are important things that we have to differentiate. So meaning just because you have those symptoms doesn't necessarily mean you have the virus, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you don't. And so I think a thoughtful approach is what's going to be required. Next. And you all know this slide about cough etiquette, avoiding contact with those that are ill, the social distancing. I've heard a lot of different measurements as far as what's appropriate, but a lot of people at least are maintaining the 6 feet difference, and that's kind of what we try and do. I've gone into some stores recently where they actually have it marked on the floor with tape, so I think that's kind of an interesting approach. But keep in mind that it's really just an opportunity for you to think about trying to distance yourself. And many of our patients, and it's going to be dependent on your local and state approaches, but some people are wearing masks out in public and those sorts of things. And we're starting, obviously, hospitals are doing that for the most part now, and clinics wearing masks, not only the providers, but also the patients. Obviously, frequent hand washing is important. They say about 20 seconds. I know my kids are doing it well because they sing happy birthday to me. And when they complete, that's about 20 seconds. So that's an easy takeaway for you. And just something that you can kind of keep in mind. Try and avoid touching your face if you can. I have trouble with this part of it as well. So it's not as easy as it might sound, but I think it is important to try and at least, if you can, avoid touching your face. And if you do, obviously wash your hands. And then, as we know, for all cardiomyopathy substrates, as I was telling you earlier, nutrition is paramount because of the energy requirements, especially for those patients with reduced ejection fraction. And we know that exercise, sleep, all those sorts of things are going to maintain your homeostatic milieu working as well as it possibly can. And so obviously getting good sleep, good nutrition, I think is important. And I would say that's a generality that should be applied to all of us. And then, as we said, avoid gatherings of people it's a large volume of people or anyone who may be ill. And obviously I would counsel Lisa this aggressively, transplant patients, we tell people very strongly, do not expose yourself unnecessarily. And I think it applies to anyone with underlying cardiomyopathy, because if you become ill, if you think about HCM and you go in, one of the first things they're going to try and do is volume resuscitate you, most likely. And so when you do those sorts of things, obviously your potential for flash pulmonary edema and other things are there. So we just want to be thoughtful that if you don't have any signs or symptoms, to go in and say, I may be ill, I may be hypotensive, whatever the case may be. Anything we can do to keep you out of those as emergency rooms, one, avoids exposure, but two, avoids potentially incorrect therapies. And so those are things such as stopping your medications or aggressively volume resuscitating are obviously things that we don't want to do.
Next. I want to pause there for just a second.
So I just wanted to speak briefly, and you all are familiar with a lot of this information already.
I think
is
we have
slide not moving?
Okay. My question before we go to their questions, and I'm going to get you're here. You're a little delayed. You had a little glitch in your audio. The question. We just lost him. He's going to come back to us in just a second. At least I hope so. My question to him is going to be about the question of vitamin C, vitamin D, and zinc. I'm hearing a lot of reports from physicians that it's really important to make sure that you're taking your normal precautions and taking your vitamins. And he's back. Yep. You're going to join us right back on the screen in 1 second, and we're just going to pop that down, and we've changed positions. So yeah, that's probably better, because we were your audio was good the whole time, but we lost some of your videos for some time. I was going to ask you the question about vitamin C, vitamin D, and zinc. We've been hearing some reports that these could be things that can help boost your immune system to make you less susceptible to COVID. What do you think? Is that a good suggestion to keep these vitamins up, or is it?
I think it's great idea, a great question. You know, you have to remember when you think about supplements, and we deal with this, and Lisa and I have talked about this, not for vitamins necessarily, but other supplements, is that classically, we try and supplement people that actually have a deficit, right? So, you know, some things we'll actually measure, like vitamin D, for example, or CoQ10 or whatever. We can measure these sorts of levels and see if you really need supplementation. So I think that's always a good caveat or jumping off point, because when you take supplements, and we were just talking about this prior to the beginning of the cast, is that you don't always know if you're getting exactly what you think you're getting. So are you really getting a certain dosage? Remembering that a lot of these don't have FDA oversight, so you don't really know.
Right.
When you talk about vitamins, for example, I would caution people to think about it in sort of a binary way. So one is that some are fat soluble and some are water soluble. So fat solubles mean that you can store them, and those are vitamin A, D, E, and K, okay? And so the potential to become toxic with those is real. So if you take too much vitamin D, you can become toxic. If you take too much vitamin E, you can become toxic. Now, others such as vitamin C, those aren't really fat soluble. So whatever you take that's extra is typically going to be excreted in the urine. I personally do take supplements of vitamin C and things like that, because I don't think there's a lot of downside per se. Vitamin D and other things, though, you might want to be a little more careful, and it may be worth actually checking your levels. If you have a reasonable diet and you're getting some sun exposure, typically you are okay. But we do know vitamin D can potentially impact myocardial function. We've had this ongoing debate for a long time. So I do think making sure that it's adequate is important. But if you had a real question about that ADK, I would suggest, you know, check and see where you are. The other ones, things like vitamin C, I think it's okay to supplement, and I don't think there's a real downside, I guess, necessarily to it, except maybe the expense.
Zinc, yes, no?
You know, I really haven't, as from a personal experience, I have used zinc occasionally in the setting of an upper respiratory infection, and I think it didn't hurt anything, you know. As far as daily zinc supplementations, I don't do anything more than a multivitamin typically. So that's where I would usually stop, unless you had an obvious deficit, you know, for some metabolic reason otherwise, or underlying reason absorption or something you might. But otherwise, I think a multivitamin is good.
Okay. So back to your presentation. I'm sorry.
No problem. So hopefully everyone can see the screen, and many of you are familiar with these kinds of flow diagrams when it comes to the management of HCM. And you hear this through the HCMA about when we parse out hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, a few things that we want to know. One is sudden death risk, and we have a paradigm for that, but also about how do you treat symptoms, right? That's a big bucket for us. Meaning, are you obstructed or not? And are you symptomatic in the face of that obstruction? And some of you may have been treated or are being treated with things like beta blockers or calcium channel blockers or disopyramide. But also remembering, some people can also be treated with angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, so ACE inhibitors, so like lisinopril, ramipril, are common therapies in the United States. Angiotensin receptor blockers, so like losartan, candesartan, valsartan. And the thing that's not on this slide but is also of importance is a drug class called ARNI, so angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitors, which is Entresto. And so we're starting to see a lot of patients on that therapy. And I don't know if you've been watching the news, reading the literature, but there is this ongoing global debate on whether people should continue these classes of medicines, ACE, ARBs, ARNIs, or should they stop? And there's a pathophysiologic reason, and it has to do with ACE2 receptors and susceptibility to viral transfection into the cells. And so there's a lot of ongoing debate about this, but you can imagine some patients, if we decided to stop these medications abruptly, it could be a bad thing. And so meaning, obviously, we use them for heart failure, as you all know. sometimes we use them though for blood pressure control, for example, or other things. And oftentimes we will use them and, you know, as a combined, we do get some benefits of afterload reduction, so blood pressure lowering, but also those favorable effects on the myocardium and changes in the neurohormonal axis and all these other sorts of things that you can read about. So next slide. So this has been an ongoing thing. We've been actively discussing this as a cardiology community. And so, like I said, I have the good fortune to be involved in a lot of leadership opportunities, I guess, in the college. And so there was a statement that came out relatively recently. And basically it says that if you're already on these therapies, we feel like staying on them is probably the right thing to do. And there really isn't enough data out there to say one way or the other, you know, if patients are on these therapies, does it mean that you're more likely to have a bad outcome? And so we're still trying to figure that sort of information out. And part of that's going to come through registries and other things that we're trying to stand up currently. But, and obviously as a part of those studies, we would include hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients. But for right now, we think everyone staying put is the right answer. Now, obviously that could be individualized. And if you were having untoward side effects from these therapies, different discussion, right? But just if as a baseline and you're doing well and you're on an ARB, and obviously we use ARBs and HCM for antifibrotic effects and other things that we've been looking at studying. So we tell people to stay on those medications unless you're otherwise obstructed. So just something that I hope will maybe help you navigate some of the confusion, I guess, that's going on right now about therapies. Next slide. And this just underscores that sort of option is that, you know, staying on these medicines makes sense.
Yeah.
So the other thing that I wanted to bring up, and I think it's interesting, even as cardiologists, people don't recognize this. It's like, oh, well, I need to bring them into the office. Well, do you? So sometimes you have to think about it. What else can I leverage? Well, obviously you have things like telehealth, you know, and you can FaceTime and PMD and all these other sorts of things, and where you can do face-to-face interactions, you can do phone calls, but that doesn't give me physiologic data for the most part, right? Unless maybe you're checking your blood pressure, your weight or something like that. So as you know, some of you have devices that are indwelling and things like implantable loop recorders. So that might be like a link device, for example. Those are things that we can look at, as you've heard before, maybe from me, is that these loop recorders are not therapy devices. They are diagnostic devices. Okay. So meaning they won't pace you, they won't shock you, but they give us information about your heart rhythm. Well, interestingly, there's some newer technology in these devices that can give us more information, and it's not quite ready for prime time yet in the United States, but it will be, in that these devices also have the ability to check temperature. They have the ability to look for congestion. So as you may have heard from your providers, if you have a pacemaker, an ICD, we can get an idea of your volume status, and we look at it over time for trends. So these data sets are available. And if you have any of these devices, that information is there and it is being transferred on a regular basis to your provider. And so for us, for heart failure, you know, if we have someone who has, let's say it is a hypertroph and maybe they have had a primary prevention placement of a defibrillator, there are more data that I can get off that than just if you got shocked or not. So that's an important thing to keep in mind. And it really is remote monitoring. And this is the evolution of where cardiology is going in the future, whether that's handheld technologies and asking you on your iPhone if you took your medicines, or are we actually monitoring hemodynamic data or rhythm data? And so this is personalized ambulatory medication or monitoring that is remote in nature. So I would encourage you, if you have any of these devices, to make sure your providers are taking as much opportunity as they can from that. So next slide. So I think, you know, just to sort of wrap up, we know that you have to be alert. And as I said, this is really a fluid conversation for us. And every day I see new announcements, not obviously from the federal level, but from our state and local levels. And as many of you have probably seen, your local, your state governors can have a tremendous impact on what you're doing when it comes to staying at home and what are the implications about shutting down businesses, those sorts of things. And then obviously locally, I think it's important because as Lisa and I both advocate, you know, we feel strongly that if you have HCM, being managed in an HCM center of excellence is an important thing, meaning someone that's caring for you is familiar with HCM. Well, we also know that not everyone lives close to an HCM center, right? And so some people do travel to come and see us, and we appreciate that. But we also know if you get ill, you're not gonna be able to fly to Memphis to see me necessarily, or to fly to New York or to Boston or wherever the case may be. So you wanna keep in mind that, you know, you are your strongest advocate, and you'll hear me say this all the time. People need to be educated, and you are the conduit to do that. So make sure that they're aware of what you have and what is going on, what your medications are, and don't allow them to do something that is unnecessary that could result in an untoward or bad outcome, okay? So be aware of what is around you locally. You know, we've established things here where you can actually do sort of a drive-by testing for COVID where you don't even get out of your car. That's pretty interesting, and I think that's a pretty progressive idea. If you can do those sorts of things, I think it minimizes your exposure and it gives you some information. As you know, Lisa is very contemporary in her approach and will constantly be updating information on the website. And so continue to look there as much as you can to make sure that there are no changes or anything that are going on. And then, as I said, continue your current management pathway.
Oh, we just lost him again. He has not got a really good internet connection. He will pop back on in just a moment. And while we get Dr. Jefferies back on with us, I will take the time to tell you that this clip will be uploaded to the HCMA website as well as our YouTube channel after broadcast today here on Facebook. And you can get to that by dropping into 4HCM.org, looking. I do. We're going to just bring you back on the screen. I'm just taking the opportunity to update them as to where we can find.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. Yeah. I don't know why the connection.
The internet. I think a lot of people are using the internet.
Okay.
A couple of days. So.
Please do. Yeah. And the last slide.
Yep. Here we go.
Yeah, no, it's probably true. Last slide is just, so as we said, you know, obviously what we're giving is pretty high level suggestion advice. And as you all know, we can't really prescribe therapies to individuals in this sort of a manner. But as I said, you can be your own advocate. And a lot of this really is common sense. So before you change anything, please make sure you talk with your provider. As you're going to hear from any good HCM provider, stay hydrated, stay hydrated, stay hydrated, right? So continue to do that as much as possible, especially now that things are starting to get warmer and whatnot. And I think when people are at home, they may eat more, but they may drink less, you know. So just something to keep in mind that you stay hydrated, monitor your symptoms, look for shortness of breath, look for weight gain, all those sorts of things, because obviously we want to be cognizant of COVID, but we also want to be cognizant of heart failure. Try and avoid ill contacts. And then as much as you can, continue to practice social distancing. I know it's been a challenge for a lot of people, but I do think that it makes sense to at least try as much as we can. Last slide. And just so, and many of you may have this information, but I have two different emails here that are on the screen that Lisa can circulate. And I'm happy to try and help answer any questions, facilitate any connections that you need. As you all know, it's a relatively small community of HCM providers. So if you need help seeing someone, getting access, anything else, I'm always happy to try and assist. So with that, thank you all for your time. Looks like we have a few questions, so I'll flip it back over to Lisa and she can tell me what they are.
We do have a little bit of a time delay here, so if we're stepping on each other, I apologize. It looks like we have just a little audio glitch occasionally. My first question is, are you doing virtual visits at this point for your existing patients, or if anybody were interested in a consult, could they contact you for a virtual visit during COVID?
Sure. Great question. We're doing virtual visits and we're looking at multiple platforms about how best to do that. I can do it as simple as doing FaceTime up to doing Zoom and other things as well, but we absolutely are seeing existing patients and I am seeing consults as well.
Very good. Okay, so I'm gonna scroll back up here. Peggy has a question regarding her 24-year-old son. And when I ask these questions, I'm going to generalize them because when we're asking very specific, that puts the doctor in an awkward position taking a consult on somebody he doesn't know that's not his patient. So I'm going to generalize the questions. Would a 24-year-old with HCM who is overweight have any greater risk than anybody else of developing COVID?
I lost your audio, Lisa. Sorry about that.
Okay. Am I back yet?
Yeah, the 20-year-old. I'm sorry. I heard the 20-year-old component.
24-year-old, little obese, with a defibrillator, higher risk of developing COVID or the same as everybody else?
That's a good question. I think... I guess how I would answer that is I'm not necessarily sure that means you're more likely to develop COVID or not. Some of that may be genomics and other things. What I would say is that how are you going to react to COVID? And the thought would be is that someone with underlying myopathy probably would react differently than I would. So do I think that the potential to be a little sicker, quote unquote, or to experience respiratory problems or otherwise maybe a little bit higher in someone with HCM, I think that's a reasonable thought. But the idea of, is it more likely or less likely you're gonna get the virus? That's a big question. And you have to remember to get the virus, we really don't even understand prevalence at this point because it's not like we're testing everyone in the United States. We actually don't have any idea of incidence or prevalence at this point. So I would say, not so much about the acquisition of the virus, but how you're going to behave to the virus might be a little bit differently.
So that answered Robin's question as well. I think what's critical is if somebody were to develop COVID and somebody on this broadcast is an HCM post-myectomy, she just disclosed here that she has had COVID for about 2 weeks now. So we know that people with HCM are getting this. We're not seeing any great spike in that they're the ones doing poorly or they end up on ventilators more often or on oxygen in the hospital. They seem to just kind of be rolling with it like most people are rolling with it. And we don't have a lot of data. Actually, I have a call after this with a research team out of Oregon who is trying to collect a registry. So you'll be hearing about that soon. So I don't necessarily know that it's that bad. So Dolores wanted to know, is it dangerous for someone to for HOCA? I'm going to be detailed here. If you have obstruction, is it more dangerous potentially than the non-obstructeds? Do you think yes or no? More complicated with obstruction?
This is my own view, but I think anyone with obstruction... I think it would be because potentially more simply because of that opportunity to become dehydrated, to worsen your degree of obstruction and to potentially lead to pulmonary venous congestion. So you're compounding edema on top of maybe a pneumonitis or a bronchitis or a pneumonia from COVID. So I do think obstruction might be an important differentiator between, people without obstruction. I would anticipate may potentially tolerate a significant viral infection better than someone with obstruction.
Should people with HCM, 15-year-old boys and otherwise, be wearing a mask if they go outdoors?
I think that's a great question. I have to admit, I've started wearing a mask when I go outside, and it may be a little bit overzealous, but I don't think there's a lot of downside. And can I tell you definitively it makes a difference? I can't. But I think it's one of those things that, remember, people are dying from this infection. And so just as you hear from your provider every year, get a flu shot. Similar thing, if there's anything we can do to mitigate or avert a true exposure and a true infection, I think it's a reasonable thing. So would I tell everyone to wear a mask? No, I don't think I have that kind of insight. But do I think it's a reasonable thing to do? I do.
I would agree. Hydroxychloroquine. What do we know?
Lisa, are you there?
I'm here. Hydroxychloroquine? Yes, no, what do we know?
So as the scientist component of me would say, we don't know enough at this point to use hydroxychloroquine. I think as you hear from Dr. Fauci in his briefs, that he's quite cautious about saying that this is a beneficial therapy, and I think that's probably a smarter thing to do. As you all know, anyone that's been involved in some of the studies that we do, let's say something like mavacamten, how many years and patients does it take to understand if it is beneficial, right? And that's a long process. And so I do think it comes back to, are there going to be therapies out there that might be beneficial for COVID? Sure. But do I think it's way more complicated than what we're seeing? Yes, I do. And there are going to be some genomic factors. Remember, viruses don't just jump into cells for the heck of it. Most of the time you have receptors that those viruses bind to. Some people are going to have those receptors and some people won't. And that's not as simple as shotgunning given therapies to people, just broad range and hoping that they work. So I think we have to be cautious because all of these medicines, even water, if you drink too much, is toxic, right? So anything that you do, you have to take it with the other side of, well, what are the downsides? What are the side effects? What are the toxicities that you have to keep in mind when you prescribe these therapies? So I think it just requires more data, honestly. No.
I would agree. This is a tricky question. So HCM patients, should they get priority COVID testing? Because testing is limited, we know. But should they jump to the front of the line because they have an underlying cardiac condition? Mm-hmm. Tricky question.
I think that's a good question. I guess I would suggest that compared to the general public, if you had similar symptoms, it probably does make sense to test that patient with underlying cardiac disease in a more timely fashion. You know, when it comes to resources,
we are not having a good time with technology. There's Dr. Jefferies. And I apologize for that. The internet seems to be a little bit busy today, and he's in Memphis, and I'm in New Jersey, and there's a lot of people on the internet.
screen. And
can you hear me?
We're back. You're back.
You hear me?
Yeah. I hear you.
Okay, sorry. So as I was saying, I think it's hard to decide about who gets resourced first, but we do know there are some people that are presenting to the ERs with cardiac arrest. So not just failing pulmonary, you know, requiring intubation, but true cardiac arrest. And obviously that's going to be less well tolerated in someone with HCM. And one might argue you might be a little more challenging to successfully resuscitate. And so in my mind, I think if you had similar symptoms between someone who had HCM and someone who did not, I would like to test the HCM patient first.
So you bring up a very good point about cardiac arrest. And I brought this up in a talk the other day with another physician. The state of New York, or actually New York City, and I think Long Island as well, if they cannot resuscitate you in the field, they will do paramedic supported life support. But if they cannot get a heartbeat back, they're not going to transport you to the hospital for advanced life support. He'll be back with us in just a moment. I'm just going to leave my picture over here. So we're recommending that families who have HCM and don't have implantable defibrillators, this may be the time you want to consider getting an AED in the home. I'm hoping that we can get the doctor back here with us in just a moment to chime in on that. But I'm not sure he's going to be able to get back in. This one's taking him a little bit longer. Maybe he's going to log all the way back out. So I will have him review some of these questions later and we can bring it back to him. I will tell you, I will answer some of these questions from what I've heard in our other videos that we've been doing for the past couple of days, 2 weeks now. And we will try to get you some answers. So I'm going to bring up Amanda, who joined late. He had myectomy 2 years ago. He had obstruction. Oh, he's back. Oh, I don't know what happened there. There you go. Technology is not cooperating today. So we're going to bounce to another question. If somebody had obstruction but had a myectomy, are they?
Yeah, the internet, I think, is overwhelmed.
Yeah. If they had a myectomy and now they're post-myectomy, so, are they a little bit more?
Yeah. Yeah, so the question is about myectomy surgery.
Do they still need to take precautions at the same level? I would say yes. Should they be taking precautions at the same level as an obstructed or not?
Yeah, I would agree. I would agree with you. I think so.
All right, next question. Should they be admitted to the hospital immediately upon diagnosis?
Probably at the level of a non-obstructed. Remember. I can see.
Okay, we're going to start doubling back here.
I'm going to close out and just do audio.
Yeah, I think we have killed this session because the audio is now gone. So I'm going to hold on 1 second. I will address Q&A offline. Okay, sorry guys. It looks like we're having a little technical difficulty here. Oh, sound is back. Now you can hear me. Okay, now I have Dr. Jefferies on the phone. As you can tell, this is not a professional studio. This is my house. This is Facebook. So now you can hear me. Okay, so going back, if somebody with HCM is testing positive for coronavirus, when do you think they should go to the hospital versus staying at home and self-monitoring and fever control and resting?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think I would always be conservative. I wouldn't necessarily go to the hospital. I would probably talk to my primary care provider and or your cardiologist and see if they have any advice about, you know, if they should be monitoring you daily. Is there anything else that they can be watching? Because, you know, remember, going to the hospital is important if you need it, but you're going to, you know, these systems are becoming overwhelmed. And so you may not necessarily have a bed or a room or anything else. And so we want you to be as safe as you can be. So in my mind, I think I would talk to my local providers about when is that line in the sand where I should go to the hospital?
Okay. So I have a question here that says, so I need to keep my 7-year-old with HCM in isolation longer than the general public. And that's a question. Can we come out of isolation at the same time as everybody else? I'm going to pause and say, I think that this virus is not going to go away anytime soon. And I believe, based on all the data that we've seen so far, that it's very highly likely that the majority of us will at some point be affected by the virus. The goal right now is to not have everybody affected at the same exact time, so that if we do require additional services, like going to a hospital, like needing oxygen, like potentially needing respiratory support with a ventilator, that we don't all try to show up at the same time. So I think it's critically important that everybody stay at home for now, let things peak and flow back out, and listen to your local community about when is safe to go back into society. And don't just jump into a big concert scene or a big party. You got to have a little common sense here, folks. You got to go slow and keep the hand washing as part of your normal life. Keep the virus control in your house with wiping surfaces and being cautious about what you're touching as part of your normal life. To the transplant community, we get indoctrinated on this once we've gotten our new heart to watch out for viruses, because we could get very sick very easily. So I encourage you all to become germaphobes along with me, yet live a normal life. It's possible to do both. So Doc, any additional comments on that?
I think Lisa's absolutely on target, and that, you know, this, I agree that this is going to be a longitudinal effort, and that this wave may be followed by other waves. And in places like New York and New Jersey, as you all know, I mean, the systems are absolutely being overrun. So I think Lisa's on target. As much as we can delay and be thoughtful, I think it gives us an opportunity for better care for everyone.
And I don't want everybody to think that the day that the restrictions are lifted, that you should, you know, have some big party or something. Everybody should kind of slowly go back out into the world and build themselves back up. Amanda, your question was answered. I'm sorry, we were having some audio problems at that time. And you're viewed as a non-obstructed patient at this time because you have had your myectomy. Obstructeds are still at the same risk as anybody else out there. The obstructeds may have some more problems because of pulmonary hypertension potentially and fluid overload that might be associated with the obstruction, but the non-obstructeds can be at the same level of risk. So just be cautious right now. Be cautious. Welcome from Florida. Lots of people saying hi. And now they can hear you much more clearly than they were on the fancy technology that we were using. So sorry about that, guys. I'm just going to scroll through here again and see if there's any other questions that we didn't address. Peggy, there aren't any centers of excellence in Baton Rouge at this time. I'm working on it. Staying here for some independence, and COVID happens and there isn't anywhere. Yeah, so if you are not in an area where there is an HCMA recognized center of excellence or one pending, like the guy on the phone here, because he hasn't sent me the papers and we have to get those papers in. But we're getting there. So anyway, what I would recommend that you do is if you do get hospitalized for COVID, reach out to a known center of excellence that you had contact with in the past. Reach out to me at the HCMA. I can help put you in contact with individuals that can assist your care team in, you know, helping you in a safe and productive way. Don't just assume, oh, well, I've never talked to a center of excellence. I haven't quite gotten there yet, or my insurance wouldn't let me, so I don't have access to that. We have a phenomenal team of healthcare professionals here at the HCMA that want to help, and they'll find ways of helping you through telemedicine or communicating with your doctors if we need to help them get some information. We've done some pretty amazing things in the past couple of weeks with lining people up with the right kind of care that they needed, COVID related or not. So use us if you have to. Okay, Dr. Jefferies, I think we're pretty much done with the questions here. Any parting thoughts before we say goodbye through this difficult conversation? I'm sorry.
Well, I want to thank everyone for their time and their patience, and hopefully you saw my email addresses, and I'm always more than available. Lisa knows how to bother me day or night and is more than welcome to. So please feel free to contact if there's anything I can do.
Fabulous. And I have your address right here up on the screen again. If anybody needs anything, do not hesitate to reach out to the HCMA and we'll make sure that you get in touch with the right people. Thank you all. And sorry about the technical difficulties today. Join us on Thursday around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Well, I will be speaking with Dr. Anjali Owens of UPenn discussing the mavacamten trial that we presented a couple of days ago when Dr. Carolyn Ho presented it through the virtual ACC meeting. But we're going to have an opportunity to dig in a little bit more into what is a clinical trial. We're going to talk about phase 1, phase 2 efficacy, and phase 2 safety trials and what the differences are and what the mavacamten data is showing us early on. So tune in with us on Thursday for that. And then next week, join me for an interview with the author of Bottle of Lies. Let's put this up on the screen. Catherine Eban. And we're going to be talking about generic drugs again. You guys liked that conversation last time. We're going to dig in deeper now. Thank you all. Have a great day. Stay safe and stay inside.